Secularism. Hello students, I welcome you to this session on secularism. The objective of this session is to discuss and understand the concept of secularism, its evolution and adoption of the concept in the Indian context, and to show how secularism is practiced in India. So let's begin by understanding the concept of secularism. Secularism is a principle of separation of the state from religious institutions. The idea that goes behind the concept is that no group or individual will be discriminated against, even if it is a minority, on the basis of religion. It also means equal respect for all religions. The public domain remains free from religion as the state does not associate itself with any one particular religion. Now let's see how secularism is defined. The Cambridge Dictionary defines secularism as the belief that religion should not be involved with the ordinary social and political activities of a country. According to the Oxford Dictionary, secularism is the principle of separation of state from religious institutions. The idea of secular state, according to modern literature, has originated in the Western countries and is associated with the concept of separation of church and the state. This meant that the state has a neutral position with regards to religion, and there is no official status given to any religion. But does this mean that citizens should not follow any religion? On the contrary, it guarantees all citizens right to follow any religion of their choice. Secularism also means when religion is not allowed to regulate affairs of the state, and the state does not directly or indirectly bring religion into the governance of the country. So, what if a particular state wants religion to influence politics? Then in that case, it won't be a secular state. In fact, it is the opposite of secularism, which is referred to as a theocratic state. It is governed by divine laws, administered by the priests of the adopted state religion. So now one wonders how this word secularism came into existence. Many scholars believe that the word secularism was coined by George Holyoake in 1851, even though the concept had emerged earlier in time. Holyoake enunciated the doctrine of secularism resting on certain principles. Firstly, science is the true guide of man rather than religion. Morality has no secular nor religious origin. Reason is the only authority. And lastly, freedom of thought and speech. So, when a society follows these principles, it can be called a secular society. Today, most of the democratic nation states with culturally diverse population have adopted secularism. Now, let's try to understand the features of a secular state. What are the kinds of provisions that are enjoyed by the people belonging to a secular state? The state extends full religious freedom to its citizens. A secular state is not anti-religious, as it does not discriminate between believers and non-believers. Hence, in a secular state, there is liberty to practice, profess and propagate one's religions and its views. People can even change their religion. People are allowed to maintain and build places of worship and other institutions that impart religious instruction. All citizens are equal before law, irrespective of their religious faith. Welfare of a state citizen is guided by reason and consideration rather than any religious dogmas. So, does this mean the state absolutely cannot interfere in religious matters? Being a secular state does not mean the state cannot interfere in religious matters, at least in India. If the religious activities or practices are endangering the security of the country or public order, or going against public morality, then the state has the right and a duty to interfere. The simple reason for this is wherever different cultures and communities exist, adopting a secular society ensures equality of treatment. Now, let's look at states which have been practicing secularism for a long time. One of the first democratic states to practice secularism even before the word was coined is USA. The Constitution of USA that came into force in 1789 provided that no religious test or qualification was required to hold any public office. The First Amendment to the US Constitution provided that its legislature shall not make any law establishing any state religion. This amendment, in the opinion of Thomas Jefferson, the founding father of USA, was to ensure a wall of separation between the church and the state. India is the other example of a multi-religious society. Such religious plurality makes secularism very important for India. India was partitioned on the basis of religion in 1947. In the backdrop of partition, adopting a tolerant attitude to diversity to maintain the integrity of nation became vital. Religious tolerance and being secular became key themes guiding the making of the Indian Constitution. But does this mean that religious tolerance was only limited to modern age of India? Traces of secularism can be found in the history of India. Let us now have a detailed look through the history of India. Let's look at the ancient Indian period first. In ancient India, the Hindu concept of Sanatan Dharma allowed to develop holistic religion by welcoming different spiritual traditions. The idea of Sarva Dharma Samabhav, which means equal regard for all religions, is based upon essential unity of all religions. Supporting this notion is the Vedic utterance of Vasudeva Kutumbakam, which means whole world is one. The Vedas, interpretation of Upanishads and Puranas, development of Charvak philosophy highlight the religious pluralism of Hindu religion, the religion of the majority population. Emperor Ashoka of the Mauryan Empire in 3rd century BC followed the policy of religious tolerance and made a law that prohibited anyone from acting against any religion. Emperor Ashoka's secular outlook is one of the landmarks of the Indian civilization. Coming down to medieval India, in medieval India, the Sufi and the Bhakti movements bound the people of various communities together with love and peace. It was the saints like Sant Kabir Das, Guru Nanak Dev, Sant Tukaram, Mirabai who contributed to the composite culture in India and highlighted the essence of being tolerant and stressed on human brotherhood. These movements brought people of all communities closer and combated religious narrow-mindedness. The Mughal emperor Akbar was truly distinctive amongst the Muslim rulers with respect to his policy towards religions in his kingdom. His policy of religious inclusiveness, tolerance, inter-religious respect was based on unity and equality. By giving equal citizenship status to both Hindus and Muslims, abolition of religious tax imposed over Hindus, which was called jizya, propagation of Din-e-Ilahi or divine faith, and Sulh-e-Kul, which meant peace with all, gave support in laying down roots of secularism. The colonial rule over India. The colonial period of India marked the introduction of systematic legal system and correspondingly secularization of law. The English enacted various laws which were meant to reform religion, such as abolition of sati, widow remarriage act, amongst others. However, after the Sepoy mutiny in 1857, the government authorities were forbidden to interfere in religious affairs. One of the other contributions of the Britishers was introduction of Western education. The modern education system encouraged scientific attitude towards human problems, ideas of liberty and equality. It also challenged traditional beliefs and imparted a secular attitude towards marriage, occupation, and other activities. Indian social reformers. Besides the Britishers, one has to mention the role played by Indian social reformers in the context of promoting secularism in India. Rajaram Mohan Roy. Rajaram Mohan Roy is described as the founder of modern India. He played a very important role in reforming the Hindu religion by opposing sati, polygamy, idolatry, and the rigid caste system. He founded the Brahmo Samaj, meant for reforming religion, and emphasized on bringing about rationalism and humanism in religion and society. Rajaram Mohan Roy also initiated modern education in India. Sir Syed Ahmad Khan. Sir Syed Ahmad Khan was a voice of tolerant views based on Western humanism with emphasis on science and reason, especially among the Muslim community. Sir Syed Ahmad Khan pleaded for a rational approach to religion, eradicating irrational traditions and customs, and called for Hindu-Muslim unity. One of his greatest contribution was in the field of education by introducing modern education, especially amongst the Muslims, through the establishment of Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College. Rabindranath Tagore. Rabindranath Tagore has been credited for bringing Western humanism and secular thought in the field of Indian literature. He highlighted the idea of Manava Dharma, or human religion, which called for acceptance of pluralism. His greatest contribution was transitioning of vernacular literature from traditionalism to modernism and giving importance to secular outlook. Swami Dayanand Saraswati. Swami Dayanand Saraswati was the founder of Arya Samaj and sought to bring about a reform movement in Hindu religion. He denounced idolatry and ritualistic worship prevalent in Hinduism. He wanted to bring about the concept of universal brotherhood and universalism for all human beings. He wanted to purge out superstitious activities in society that prevailed due to false interpretation of Vedas by the religious priests. Mahatma Gandhi. The spirit of secularism along with nationalism was strengthened and enriched through the freedom movement. In the initial part of the freedom movement, liberals like Sir Firoz Shah Mehta, Govind Ranade, G.K. Gokhale pursued secular approach to politics. But it was Mahatma Gandhi who took the national movement to the masses and championed the promotion of secularism in Indian politics. Mahatma Gandhi propagated the concept of Indian secularism through the idea of Sarva Dharma Samabhav, which means equal respect for all religions. He called for Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, Christian unity based on the concept of truth is ultimate and one. His belief in religious pluralism greatly affected the development of secularism in India. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. One of the most significant contributions of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar is promotion of secularism among the depressed classes. By creating organizations such as Bahishkrit Hitkarni Sabha, Samaj Samata Sangha, and political parties such as Independent Labour Party, All India Scheduled Caste Federation, and the Republican Party, Dr. Ambedkar helped to create political awareness amongst the depressed classes. Dr. Ambedkar used the press to spread liberal and secular ideas amongst the depressed classes. Through protests and satyagraha, Dr. Ambedkar asserted his community's equality and rights as humans. Dr. Ambedkar's conversion to Buddhism, along with his followers in 1956, was to embrace the Buddhist principles such as humanism, secularism, democratic and rational approach. Buddhism stood for principles of liberty, equality, and fraternity, which Dr. Ambedkar cherished. While being the chairman of the drafting committee, while making of the Indian Constitution, Dr. Ambedkar ensured protecting and guaranteeing the rights of the marginalized and depressed classes. Jawaharlal Nehru. Jawaharlal Nehru was deeply aware of India's historical past, which was reflected in his monumental book, Discovery of India, and was convinced about India being a plural society. He believed that any governmental structure facing diverse population must encourage it. India, a country of different faiths, culture, and language, should not be biased towards any specific religion. Coining the uniqueness of India as unity in diversity, Nehru sought to make people aware that in spite of the diversity, there is a common history and similar experiences, and hence, based on this, diversity should be respected and become base of secular India. According to Nehru, religion had no place in politics. He preferred the notion dharma nirpekshata, or that the state would not be moved by religious considerations in enacting policy. Nehru emphasized on development of scientific temperament to fight religious superstition. Indian Constitution and Secularism. Let us now understand secularism as given in the Indian Constitution. In the pre-independence era, there were deliberations regarding the nature of constitution that would be created once India gained freedom. To this end, the constitution drafted by Pandit Motilal Nehru, who was the chairman of the Nehru Committee in 1928, had the provision on secularism as, there shall be no state religion for the Commonwealth of India or any province in the Commonwealth, nor shall the state either directly or indirectly endow any religion, any preference, or impose any disability on account of religious beliefs or religious status. This clearly indicated the will of leaders to embrace secularism as a state policy. In the Constituent Assembly deliberations, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar said, all that a secular state means is that this parliament shall not be competent to impose any particular religion upon the rest of the people. The understanding of secular state by the Constituent Assembly was one based on equal respect for all religions or non-discrimination on the ground of religion. The question that arises here is, why did secularism become so important, especially during independence? The creation of Pakistan out of Muslim majority provinces was based on the two-nation theory that propagated that India and Pakistan are incompatible culturally and politically. The Indian leaders didn't support this claim. Riots and violence followed the partition. Circumstances surrounding independence of India were such that led to Constituent Assembly giving paramount importance to maintaining integrity of the nation. To reflect the rejection of the two-nation theory, a carefully drafted voluminous piece of constitution came into being, depicting and reiterating the mind-boggling diversity of India and also a pledge to guarantee varied rights to the same. Yet there was no direct mention of secularism or establishing a secular state in the Indian Constitution. The word secular in the Indian Constitution was added to the preamble by the 42nd Amendment Act in 1976. Does this mean that the absence of the word secular until 1976 in the Indian Constitution meant that India was not a secular nation? The preamble of the Indian Constitution resolved to secure all its citizens liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship. This meant that the Indian nation state does not identify with any specific religion and gives liberty to its citizens to choose their faith. To answer this, we need to look further into the Indian Constitution. The relationship between the Indian state and its citizens is defined in the chapter on fundamental rights, directive principles of the state policy, and fundamental duties. Rights pertaining to equality, as mentioned in the third chapter of the Constitution, states that people residing in India are guaranteed equality before law and equal protection of law. The state cannot discriminate against any citizens on grounds of religion, race, caste, sex, or place of birth. There is also equality of opportunity guaranteed with respect to public employment. Articles 25 to 28, as mentioned in the Indian constitutions, are specifically related to religious freedom. Article 25 of the constitution states that persons have the right to freely profess, practice, and propagate religion subject to certain restrictions such as public order, morality, and health. Article 26 states that every religious denomination has the right to establish and maintain institutions for religious and charitable purposes and to maintain its own affairs in matters of religion. Since there is no official state religion in India, it follows the logic in Article 27, which mentions no person shall be forced to pay taxes for promotion or maintenance of any religion. This means the state cannot collect money from people for promoting any particular religion. Article 28 provides that no religious instruction shall be provided in any educational institution wholly maintained out of state funds. The Indian Constitution gives special privileges to the religious minorities. Article 30, subclause 1, specifies that all minorities, whether religious or language, shall have the right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. These were bold ideas and progressive guarantees that made Indian Constitution distinctly secular. Is it just the chapter on fundamental rights that has clauses pertaining to secularism? No, it was not only the fundamental rights, but other parts of the constitution that also contributed to the idea of a secular state. The directive principles of state policy mentioned in the Indian Constitution are not enforceable in any court, but are vital with respect to the governance of the country. It is the duty of the state to apply these principles in making laws. Article 44 directs the state to secure for the citizens a uniform civil code throughout India. This still remains elusive, but the Supreme Court has reiterated in its judgments regarding the importance of the same. The 42nd Amendment Act of the Indian Constitution, besides incorporating the word secular in the preamble, also added Article 51A to the list of fundamental duties. It states that it is the fundamental duty of every citizen of India to promote harmony, spirit of brotherhood amongst all people of India, and to also develop scientific temper, humanism, and principle of inquiry and reform. Thus, the state strives to achieve a secular society by instructing the people along with the necessary religious liberty guaranteed by the Indian Constitution. To put it in a nutshell, the word secular implies in the Indian Constitution. Firstly, it means there is no official religion that India proclaims to have, and the government has no right to impose a particular religion as an official religion. Secondly, the citizens are considered to be equal and treated as equals irrespective of their religious beliefs. Thirdly, the state cannot discriminate against any person with respect to entry into government service or admission into educational institute on the basis of religion. Fourthly, the state can interfere in few aspects of any religion to reform its practices. However, it maintains a principal distance, and the interference should be based on the ideals given in the Constitution. Secularism in practice. We all have seen in the earlier section how the Indian Constitution provides for the formation of a secular state. This section tries to analyze the working of the concept of secularism in India. By and large, Indians have enjoyed a great deal of freedom for practicing, professing, and propagating their respective religions. One of the foremost ways to prove our secular credentials is the fact that India has more than 80% Hindu population, and yet other religions continue to exist and thrive in our country. In India, there are a few states like Jammu and Kashmir, Union Territory of Lakshadweep, where the minority makes up the majority. Other states like Assam, Goa, Kerala, Nagaland, Manipur, Mizoram, Meghalaya, Tripura, Uttar Pradesh and West Bengal have high percentage of minority population. The promise of non-discrimination in matters of employment duly stated in the Constitution has not merely been lip service but is an actual reality in India. It is a matter of pride and proof of our secular credentials that we have had four presidents from the religious minority community. Besides this, substantial numbers of minorities are in the armed forces, science and technology, education, civil services, politics, among others. India's film industry and sports like cricket, tennis have produced stars and sportsmen who are literally worshipped irrespective of their religion. In general, the Indian government has not been indifferent to religion but has attempted to treat each religion equally. Threats to secularism. Having a multicultural and religious society creates great difficulty in governance of the same. In this section, let's try and understand how the ideal of secularism has been threatened in India. One of the greatest threats to secularism in India has been communalism. Communalism means tendency to look at administrative, political, economic problems from a point of view of a particular religious community. Communalism stands for exploiting religion for political or economic ends. It makes religion an instrument in power politics. Complicating this is the logic with which competitive party politics, vote bank politics operates. Besides growth of communal parties, communal riots, massacres, violence, communal interpretation of history, intolerance towards minorities are perhaps one of the most serious challenges to Indian politics and society. In spite of all this, can we really call India secular? The answer to this question is a resounding yes. The most important proof is the mere fact that India has survived for nearly 70 years with the given socio-religious diversity. India has stayed integrated as a country since 1947 and not allowed for fissiparous tendencies to fester. There have been times when the threat of separatist tendencies arose but were cleverly met by responses from the Indian state, at times through negotiations and at times by use of force. There have also been times when communalism has raised its ugly head threatening our secular existence. However, Indian people have not yet imbibed the communal ideology and are still basically secular. The vision of a secular state and society embedded in the Constitution by its framers along with the resilience of people needs to be reiterated in the practice of secularism in India. Thank you.